Good morning.
It's so good to hear all of your voices and seeing all your smiles, as it is every Sunday. I'm just thankful that we are all here together. Thank you for joining us here at Eastborough Church of the Nazarene. And I pray that you all have a good morning so far. Today we're going to be reading Psalm 111. Praise the Lord. I will thank the Lord with all of my heart as I meet with his godly people. Amen. How amazing are the deeds of the Lord. All who delight in him should ponder them. Everything he does reveals his glory and majesty. His righteousness never fails. Who can forget the wonders he performs? How gracious and merciful is our Lord. He gives food to those who trust him. He always remembers his covenant. He has shown his great power to his people by giving them the lands of other nations. All he does is just and good, and all his commandments are trustworthy. They are forever true, to be obeyed faithfully and with integrity. He has paid a full ransom for his people. He has guaranteed his covenant with them forever. What a holy, awe-inspiring name he has. Reverence for the Lord is the foundation of true wisdom. The rewards of wisdom come to all who obey him. Praise his name forever.
This morning, could we go ahead and stand and open in prayer? You bow your head with me. Our dear Heavenly Father, we're so thankful that you are always there for us and that you take care of us and for how great and mighty you are. I pray that you'll be with each one of us this morning, and thank you for each person that's here. Be with Pastor Dan, be with the music. God, I pray that you'll use everything to bring you glory. In your name, amen. Our first psalm this morning, might as well stand up for it too. Psalm 145:1 says, every day I will praise you and extol your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation will commend your works to another. They will tell of your mighty acts. Our first psalm today is, Great is the Lord. If you will stand up with us, please.
Trust in his love. Great is
Our mission statement is to transform lives by making Christ-like disciples wherever we go. I'd like to do some of the announcements. Zeta?
Good morning, brothers and sisters in the name of Jesus. This is a beautiful day. And we praise the Lord for the opportunity that we can be together to worship our Lord, but also to enjoy the communion among us. We have downstairs 12 children and like 6 babies. It's really busy downstairs, but praise the Lord for this little heart that are hearing God's voice. I am here because I want to tell you that we all together really did a good activity last Sunday. I want to tell you that we have more than 200 kids. We bring 240 cards, praise the Lord. We bring 240 cards and we have left 20 cards. So we have about 220 kids without counting the adults. And Rhonda told me, do you remember in the Bible when Jesus just counted the men when he fed the 5,000? Well, right now we just count the kids. We don't know how many adults we have, but we have the drawings. We have the drawings, and the kids were not here. So my husband, because your pastor is on sabbatical, so my husband and me on Wednesday night we went to the houses, and it was great being in the community. We went to a couple of streets here for a girl who won the bike. She was excited. She was, as soon as they opened the door, she just ran and jumped on me, and she was so happy, hugging and with the bike, excited. We invited them to the church, and we prayed that they come. We went to some of the apartments, somewhere, I think here, yeah, well, we went to the apartments, and we find another family that a girl won a prize, and they were so happy. And they said, thank you, tell thank you to the church for what you do for the community. And the community is doing what we are doing for them. And the beautiful thing that we are doing for them is presenting the gospel. Jesus Christ as the only hope. And then we went to other apartments, and we have 2 Hispanic families. And it was great talking with them and giving them their prizes. One of the winners of a football soccer ball was a Hispanic boy, and he was so excited because it was a good soccer ball. So what I want to tell you, thank you, because who knows if the candy that you brought, if the money that you gave was in the hands of these people, was in the hands of this family. Thank you for your cards. And I will finish. We had 16 cards. 16 cards, beautiful cards. One of those cards had the I spies. And you know, it was a card with many different things and a list of different things that they defined. So the person who was running the I spy card was asking the kids, okay, can you spy a spoon? Can you spy a doll? Can you spy something? But among all of those things, it was a Bible. And she said, can you spy a Bible? And she told me, 2 kids asked, what is a Bible? And 1/3 kid says, oh, I never see a real Bible. I never see a Bible in my life. Brothers and sisters, what you did was showing God's word to those kids, to those parents, and to our community. And I just want to say thank you. Thank you for praying. I know that the prayers were the key. We have an awful weather, but just in the time that we were outside, the mist stopped and come back when we finish. But thank you so much for your prayers. We cannot do anything without the support of your prayers. Thank you so much for the candy, for the money, and thank you so much for bringing your car and helping with many, many different things. Thank you, church. We love you. I want to thank Kimberly and her husband. They were running the hot chocolate that was so much appreciated. Everybody was so much in love with that chocolate. Everything was perfect because we all work together. God bless you. I need to run. So now keep praying for the Christmas program.
Thank you, Zeta. And now the whole Christmas project boxes are due next Sunday. So bring them next Sunday. There are a few back there, not that many. So if you still want to do one or maybe a couple, I think there were a few more left back there.
It's due today, Tina.
What?
I made it, apparently listed it wrong. It's due today.
No, it's due next Sunday.
Yeah, it's next Sunday.
Next Sunday.
Yep. That's okay. That's all right. So they're due next Sunday, okay? I didn't bring mine today either, so. We are still looking for a van driver for Sunday mornings. And it's a needed ministry. It's an important ministry. Be in prayer about it. Maybe God's already spoken to you. Listen to what his voice is telling you. You will be blessed more than you realize, okay? Van ministry, we need somebody to drive. Next Sunday, November 14th, our wonderful pastor will be back. Woo-hoo!
Yeah.
Thank you. Yep. We miss him. We're trying to avoid pastor when he walks right in to not just flood him. Maybe wait till after service to give him a minute to kind of come in and catch. I'm one of those that would just be right there. So that's going to be hard for me. But we need to give him time to come in and take a breath, okay? So maybe after services and stuff, we can kind of do that a little bit. But keep him in prayer this week, as well as his beautiful wife and their beautiful daughters, okay? Let's see. Rhonda.
Rhonda, over here?
Yeah.
Good morning, everyone. I was watching Pastor Zeta, and I was just like, oh, I don't have that much energy today. So pretend everything she said in Spanish, and then I said it. So, I am so honored and blessed. I'm gonna try to get through this without crying too much, but to work with our youth here. This past weekend, we had a quiz, our first quiz of the year, actually, because the ones in September and August both had gotten canceled. In Durango, Colorado. If you're not familiar with geography, that's 6 hours away from here. So Friday after school, I loaded up Sarah Lynch and Hannah Lynch and Breland Casnon and Eric Marin, and we went to Durango. Let me tell you how special these students are. That 6 hour drive, they took a 20 minute break. The rest of it, they just studied. They probably know about more about Romans 1 through 9 than most of the rest of us in the room. Not everybody, but most of us, because of how hard they studied those chapters. It paid off competition-wise, but of course the competition isn't the point. The point is to be in God's Word. At the quiz, we were second place, and they missed. They missed me in first place by 20 points, which is one question and one quiz. They were that close. Now let me explain something. Three of these quizzers, basically this is their second year. One, it was her first quiz ever. She had never seen teen Bible quizzing at all. Great job, Reed. Placements, individual placements, it showed as well. Hannah was 12th place. Eric was 7th place. Bree was 6th place. Sarah was 3rd place. She was one question from me and Tyler first. That's our students. But let me tell you what I'm really proud about. On the way back, we stopped at IHOP. Because, you know, I wanted to do something special for them, so we're sitting to eat instead of just rush through. While we were there, I'm glad she's not up here because she's going to be very embarrassed when she hears I tell the story. But while we were there, Sarah had noticed, she had excused herself and went to the restroom. She came back, and she had noticed that one of the wait personnel had run into the ladies' restroom, and she was crying. And it just touched Sarah so much. She came back to the table, and she said, "Miss Rhonda," she was crying. So I had an opportunity, and I'm not somebody that I do this often or regularly, not nearly as much as I should, but because of Sarah's tender heart, I had an opportunity to pray with Zandria, this young lady. She didn't share everything. All she told me was that she was really stressed right now. But you should have seen her face to see that a young girl had noticed her and cared enough to share with someone else. That's our young people. And that's living out the love of God. On the way back, you know, we didn't have to study, but Sarah's still asking questions. It was kind of funny. She was like, all into here, let me ask you questions on Romans. But then they started singing. And they sang for a while, and if y'all know Taylor Swift, I can confirm, or some of our students know almost every word to every song ever. But then they started singing worship songs. We started going through, we played, and they would sing along. My last hour and a half in the car with them was these three angelic voices lifting up the word, lifting up our Lord. That's our young people. We need help, just like we need van drivers. We need help with Bible quizzing with our youth. Even if you can't commit once a week, if you can do once a month, if you can do once a quarter, if you love young people, if you love God's word, please reach out to Pastor Ben or myself so that we can also afford you the opportunity to be blessed by these young people. Thank you for allowing me this honor. Thank you, guys.
Let's get ready for our offering time. And after the prayer, we will have to put your offering on either side of the building or at the back of the sanctuary. Let's pray. Father God, our hearts are overflowing right now with all the reports we've heard this morning and how we've been praying and praying and praying for our Sunday night last week and how now we want to diligently follow up with praying, Lord, for the many people who walk through our neighbors who walk through our yards here and heard your message. We know that you planted seeds through us last week, and now it's your turn to water them and our turn to just be here and be available and be watching as Sarah and Rhonda have done. We just pray that we will continue in this enthusiasm for getting your word into this gospel, into this community. And we just ask that you would be with each of us as we give from our first fruits to your work today. Thank you for this time to share. Thank you for the ministry of worship and praise we've had together with music and testimony this morning, and we look forward to our remainder of our service. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, since Thursday is Veterans Day, we wanted to recognize the veterans here today. Our next song is a medley of the anthems of each of the branches of the armed service. Hopefully, you know more of them than I do, but we're learning things. So if you would stand, if you were a member of the military, whenever they play your branch's anthem, we'd like you to stand. Say your spouse was in the military, or he's not here, or she, if you would go ahead and stand and represent them for the branch of the military he was in. So, he or she. Anyway, let's go ahead and start our song.
Thank you.
ultimately God who has given us the freedom that we have in this country, but God used our military to help bring these about. I want to share a poem I found. It's called It Is the Veteran. It is the veteran, not the minister, who has given us freedom of religion. It is the veteran, not the reporter, who has given us freedom of press. It is the veteran, not the poet, who has given us freedom of speech. It is the veteran, not the campus organizer, who has given us freedom to protest. It is the veteran, not the lawyer, who has given us the right to a fair trial. It is the veteran, not the politician, who has given us the right to vote. It is the veteran who salutes the flag, who serves beneath the flag, and whose coffin is draped by the flag, who allows the protesters to burn the flag. Remember that whenever you think of our armed services. Pastor Dan?
You know, when Sam Guy unplugged you, you know it's going to be a long day. So, thank you to our veterans, each one of you who have served our country. You are truly indebted to each one of you, and we appreciate that so much. We do want to go to the Lord in prayer today. I'm a little bit sharp here, if you want to bring that back a little bit. We do have several people within our church who are sick. We think especially of Alan and Judy. One reason why we don't have our bulletins and folders and all of that is our church secretary is sick, so that always kind of throws us back, and we just found that out later in the week, and so we didn't have a chance to do that. So my son-in-law and daughter were saying, well, we don't have anything to write our notes on, so I guess you write it on the back of your hand or something, but you'll figure that out. We do want to be just praying for them, and AJ, who had surgery this past week, and some really good reports of having his intestines reattached, which they were waiting to do for quite some time, but he still is going to be in the hospital probably about another week or so. We need to be praying for his healing as everything kind of gets working as it should. We also need to continue praying for Carol Ebert, who fell a couple weeks ago and broke her hip and fractured her pelvis in a couple places. And so we want to continue praying for her. She's in rehabilitation, seems to be doing pretty well, but we need to continue praying for her healing. And of course, Rhonda, it's her mother, as Rhonda carries a lot of the care of those types of things as well. And so there are many other prayer requests as well. Deb Rogie has COVID, and she's really struggling with that. That's hit her pretty hard, and she's back in the hospital. Susan Nulahite, who they used to be members of our church, her mother just died a couple weeks ago, and her brother-in-law passed away this past week. And so just praying for that family as many of these situations are going on. In the midst of these types of things, though, we're reminded of the God to whom we go in prayer. And this God who loves us, who cares for us, who knows so well what we need. And so as we go to prayer, then we don't go telling God what he needs to do. We go as children, we go to their father or their mother and bring these things to them because of sometimes our questions, because of our hurt, because of our needs, knowing that the parent loves them so much. And that's the same Father God that we go to in prayer. And so let's go to the Lord in prayer, shall we? Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your grace and your presence in our life. And you reveal this to us in so many different ways, Father. I thank you so much, Lord, for the way you are answering prayers. And we give you thanks and praise for the opportunity we had this last Sunday to have this harvest festival in which we were able to not only give treats to kids as they came in and families as they came to our parking lot, but also to offer them the word of the gospel. And Father, we just ask that you would allow that word to be growing within their hearts and lives of something they sensed of your spirit here would draw them back. But Father, we do thank you for the way that you allowed this to be such a great event and to bring the people in. Father, we thank you for those who are recovering from COVID. I know that there are several within our church who have been sick and they are well on the way to recovery, and we give you thanks and praise for that. So you continue to strengthen them. We do ask that you'd be with Deb Rogie and strengthen her during these very difficult times for her. And we think of Alan and Judy and AJ as they're battling COVID right now, and just pray for you to bring healing to them. And we thank you that Nancy and Don Turner seem to be doing better. Pray for continued strength in their life. And Father, I know that with each of us here, there's different people we know who are struggling also with either COVID or other sicknesses. And we just offer them up to you, Father, I know that you are bringing healing and through medications and different things, that you would bring them quickly back to strength. Father, we thank you for the fact that our pastor's going to be on sabbatical for these 3 months. And as this is the last Sunday, next Sunday he'll be back with us. And we just ask, Father, that you would bless him as he comes back, and that you would continue to invigorate him as he'll come back here to lead us, as he does such a wonderful job in doing that. But Lord, we do just thank you that we've had this opportunity for him to be able to take this time away and to refresh and rejuvenate and find new energy. And we just look forward so much to having him back and being with us and leading us. Would you just bless him in this week as he starts again tomorrow with his activities. Just be close to him. Fathers, as we come into this service, then it just reminds me that one of the things we are doing is we come and we offer ourselves to you. Sometimes we talk about this as being a liturgy, and a liturgy is actually a word that talks about being poured out before God. And Father, we just ask that through our prayers and through the singing and through the different things that we do together, that this would be an offering of praise which we pour out before you. And I thank you, Lord, that you are here, your Spirit speaks to us, he encourages us, he sometimes speaks to our in our ear about things we need to be working on and things that we want to submit to you. And I thank you, Father, for the way that you are here and you deal with us in such a gentle and such a consistent way. And I'd ask, Lord, that you would find within each of us that we are opening up our hearts and our ears to hear your word, to respond to that, to be the children you've called us to be. And I thank you for the Spirit who enables that within our life as well. Father, I pray that the remainder of this service, as we are going to be looking at a passage in Daniel, that you'd be speaking to us through the witnesses of these three young men that we're going to hear about and see about here in just a couple of moments. And in this, Father, we recognize that this is the kind of faith you call from each one of us. And Father, one of the things that we do here as we come into your presence is we look for that encouragement in difficult situations, but we also ask for your strength, that we can truly be the people you've called us to be. Because indeed, there is no God like our God. And so we give you thanks, we give you praise, and we offer ourselves up to you. These things we pray in the name of Jesus.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is Babylon News and Empire Report. We are here on location in Babylon today, where three young men have just been thrown into a fiery furnace by, you guessed it, King Nebuchadnezzar. Let's see if we can take a closer look. On second thought, that fire is pretty hot. I think I'm just gonna stand over here so I can hold on to my eyebrows a little bit longer. Oh, but wait, here comes the king now. King Nebuchadnezzar, King Nebuchadnezzar. King Nebuchadnezzar, is it true that you just sentenced three young men to die in a fiery furnace today?
They disobeyed my decree. They didn't bow down and worship when the music played. So I did what any other great king would do.
You threw them into a fiery furnace?
Oh, of course not. I had my guards do it.
I see. Well, perhaps we could speak to these guards.
I don't think they're really in the mood. They're a little burnt up over the whole ordeal.
Ah, I see. Thought that you were too harsh on the prisoners, huh?
Not really. They're like actually burnt up. I had the furnace turn up 7 times as hot this time.
7 times? That's really hot.
Let's just say if you wanted to roast a hot dog, you could do it from a different time zone.
Well, that's quite sir?
Yes.
I thought you said there were, three men in the furnace?
Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego.
You're sure?
Absolutely.
No one else in there with them?
This isn't the number one tourist attraction of Babylon, you know. What are you getting at?
Well, maybe you should take another look.
Impossible!
4, right?
Only 3 men were thrown in, bound and fully clothed.
Well, now they've got company.
This doesn't make any sense. The 4th one looks like the Son of God.
Are there any final statements you'd like to make to the press, sir?
I, Nebuchadnezzar, hereby do make a new decree. Anyone who speaks against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be destroyed.
All right, and so, as King Nebuchadnezzar frees the prisoners, we can all learn from the lesson that we have learned today, that the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego will never abandon you, even when things get a little heated. All right, back to our studios.
Going to sing a song called Days of Elijah, which you can pray. Praise God, our great Jehovah, as we sing this song.
For that great skit. They actually acted out our scripture lesson for today. And so if you have your Bibles, I'm just going to read one section of that. Come on up.
I can't sit when the Lord says get up and testify. If you have any doubt, God has great things planned for this church. You are deaf. Look at what happened here today. Look at what happened last Sunday. Look at the follow-on of those activities. We prayed, we offered ourselves to make an event happen. The Lord cleared the weather.
Amen.
He provided an outpouring of people. We prayed and He was faithful and just and answered our prayers.
Amen. Yes.
Not just in this one instance, but as we continue to pray for all those children who had a seed of the Holy Spirit and of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ planted.
Yes.
We know that our God will fertilize that seed in ways that we can't.
Yes.
Will give us a chance, bring them to our Sunday school classes, and get other outreaches, that seed will grow.
Amen.
All we did was plant it.
Yes.
That's all He asks, that when we're given an opportunity, whether it's praying for a woman that goes to the crying into a bathroom, having our eyes open to the needs of this world.
Yes.
In our neighborhoods, our neighbors, not just here in the area of the church, but at our homes. Those people still need our prayers.
Amen.
Whether they're our neighbors or five houses or two blocks away, God answers our prayers, people.
Amen.
He has recognized we are His faithful. And when we pray, He responds.
Absolutely. Amen.
Thank God.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
God's at work, folks.
Amen.
God's at work. Praise His name for that. So if you have your Bibles, I'd like to read three very significant verses out of this story, this skit we've just seen of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And that's in Daniel chapter 3. And the verse I'd like to read are verses 16 through 18. So you can just stand with me for a moment. Daniel, you want to find that, and you're running through the Psalms, and after Psalms, you're in Isaiah, and Jeremiah, and Ezekiel, and then Daniel comes up. So if you're looking for Daniel, you just find one of those bigger ones, like Isaiah, or Jeremiah, or Ezekiel. Ezekiel's going to be right after that. So we're looking at Daniel chapter 3, verses 16 through 18. Hear the word of the Lord. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to the king, "O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to save us from it, and He will rescue us from your hand, O king.
Yes.
But even if He does not, I want you to know, O king, that we will not serve your gods or worship the image of gold you have set up." Shall we pray?
Yes.
Heavenly Father, we thank You for this scripture, for this account of three young men who are bold enough to stand for their faith. I'd ask, Lord, that You would speak to us through their example this day, as Your Holy Spirit speaks to us the words He wants us to hear. These things we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. You may be seated. It was during the reign of King Jehoiakim that Nebuchadnezzar besieged Jerusalem. Among the many political prisoners and slaves who were deported to other parts of the Babylonian Empire were three young men named Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. The names of these three young men were painfully ironic reminders of the smashed faith of the Jewish people. You see, God had always protected the people of Israel. Even in the midst of seemingly unavoidable disaster, God had always miraculously turned the tide, and the people of Jerusalem had been saved. God had always defended His people. He had always defended His temple.
Amen.
Until now. Nebuchadnezzar and his Babylonian warriors had destroyed the city. They had destroyed the temple. And in the minds of many of the people, they had even destroyed God Himself. Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. They had once claimed these names with pride and trust. Their names were reflective of God's strength and grace and aid. For you see, their Hebrew names testified to their faith and their trust in God. The name Hananiah meant, "The Lord has been gracious." The Lord has been gracious. Mishael signified, he is one who comes from God. And the name Azariah meant, "The Lord is my helper." The names which were once carried with such pride and joy were now names of ridicule and hilarity. Can't you hear the taunting voices of the Babylonian conquerors? "Hey, Hananiah, tell me about how the Lord has been gracious to you. Tell me about how the Lord has been gracious to your city, Hananiah. You're a captured prisoner of war. Your city's gone. Hananiah, don't make me laugh. Hey, Azariah, the Lord is your helper, huh? Well, with a helper like that, who needs an enemy?" The sting of their defeat was sharpened by the very mention of their Hebrew names. Hananiah, "The Lord has been gracious." Mishael, "One who comes from God." Azariah, "The Lord is my helper." In Babylon, the names of these young men were found to be unsatisfactory. And so the Babylonian officials sought out new names for these three intelligent prisoners. To Hananiah, they gave the name Shadrach. No longer would he be ridiculed by the name which meant, "The Lord has been gracious." Instead, Shadrach meant the inspiration of the sun. Instead of being known as one who comes from God, Mishael was named Meshach, which meant one who belongs to the goddess Shishak. No longer would Azariah be known by the seemingly ridiculous name, "The Lord is my helper." He was called Abednego, which means servant of Nego, the morning sun. And so we meet these three young men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Their godly lives have been shaken up by captivity. Their God-praising names had been reduced to names of ridicule and scorn. And finally, they had lost their godly names completely. Who of us has gone through the trauma of a Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Who of us has been deported from our home and our family into the midst of a foreign and pagan nation? Who of us has had our faith and our God turned into the ridicule of an entire nation? As we open the book of Daniel, we catch a glimpse of these three Jewish men. But surprisingly, as we read the story, these three men had remained faithful. Despite all the chaos, despite all the turmoil, despite all their painful disappointment, they had nonetheless remained faithful to God. And miraculously, God was blessing their lives. The Bible tells us that along with Daniel, these three young men found favor in the eyes of Nebuchadnezzar. And like a phoenix rising up out of the ashes, their lives were elevated above the misery and poverty of captivity. And they were placed into positions of high honor in the king's service. They had been faithful, and God had blessed. God had given them position. Even in a foreign nation, God had given them status. For three young defeated captives, God could not have given them anything more, it would seem like. Considering their situation, they had everything they could possibly hope for. But then the trouble started again. Sometimes it happens that way, isn't it? Seems like we just get on top of a victory and the trouble starts again. Nebuchadnezzar got the idea from a dream to build a golden statue of himself. Everyone in the kingdom was commanded to bow down to the statue whenever they heard the royal music being played. Now for the Babylonians, this decree was not a problem at all. They recognized many gods. They worshipped many idols. They bowed down to many different statues. And so one more additional idol for them to worship and bow down to, it just didn't matter at all. It was not a problem. But for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, To bow down to the golden statue would be to deny the one and only God himself. The dilemma that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego faced is a dilemma which we also face today. All the details are certainly different. The immediate consequences are not so evident. I mean, if we refuse to bow down to the gods of money or power or position in our times, no one is going to throw us into a burning furnace. And yet the dilemma, despite some of the details, is very much the same. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego had to decide if they would choose to save face and bow down to the golden statue, or if they would choose to save their faith and remain true to God. I'm sorry for kind of a little bit of a corny play on words here, but I'm convinced that the reality of our Christian lives is often very much a matter of choosing to save face or to save faith. To save face or to save faith. We choose to save face when we water down the message of the gospel.
That's right.
We decide that our personal convenience is more important than divine obedience, and so we just bow down to the idol. We reason that no one would understand if we would witness about Jesus Christ, as we bow down to the statue. We argue that honesty and integrity are impossible to maintain in the dog-eat-dog realm of the business world, and we just bow down to that statue. We rationalize that God will understand our dilemma of not being able to tithe, and we bow down to the statue. We have to save face with our friends, and so we bow down. We have to save face with our colleagues, and so we bow. We have to save face with our family, and we bow down. We have to save face with our own personal finances, and then we bow. And in the name of saving face, the gospel is heard, the gospel is denied, the gospel is completely rejected. We choose to save faith when we obey God. We choose to save faith when we recognize that Jesus really is all the world to me. We save faith when our integrity before God is more important to us than our popularity around other people. We save faith when our treasure in heaven is of a higher priority than our treasure in the bank. We save faith when the purity of our life is more important than the panting of our passions. Each and every day of our lives, we are forced to choose between saving face or saving faith. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego chose to save faith. I'm captivated by the only words that we ever hear these three young men utter. In all the book of Daniel, in the midst of all that we know about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and the historical situation in which they find themselves, we nonetheless only have a couple of sentences which these young men spoke. And I read them for us this morning. They're found in verses 16 to 18 of Daniel chapter 3. They're the words which were spoken to Nebuchadnezzar when he commanded them to either bow down to the statue or to be thrown into the fiery furnace. These words reveal the godly principles by which these three extraordinary men truly lived. The first words that these three men utter in verse 16 are almost revolutionary, especially for our times, I think. As Nebuchadnezzar challenges them and threatens them, they answer with these words, "O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves in this matter." The emphasis of this sentence in the Hebrew language is placed unmistakably upon the emphatic use of the word "we" in this sentence. Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves here. The whole structure of the word portrays a trust and confidence that they had in someone outside of themselves. The fact of the matter is that when we take a stand for God, we do not need to defend ourselves. God himself is our defense.
Amen.
He is our defense.
Amen.
I wish that we could find a freedom from needing to always feel like we have to defend ourselves. We always feel like we have to defend ourselves. And so often in doing that, we turn the focus completely
on ourselves instead of upon God. And so we end up defending our actions, and we defend our attitudes, and we defend our arguments, we defend our mistakes, we end up even defending our sins. And the focus of the argument always seems to revolve around one subject, me and I. You can't talk to me that way. If you just knew my situation. So often we act as if it's all about me, all the time, for everyone. The striking thing about these three young men is that although their names have been changed, their identities had remained the same. Despite captivity, despite imprisonment, despite the loss of their temple and their city and their land, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego understood that God is our helper. They understand that everything does come from God and that God is gracious. Isn't that funny? They could change their names, they couldn't change their identities. King Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves for doing what is right. We do not need to defend ourselves. God is our helper. God is our defender. And then the young men continue on in verse 17. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to save us from it, and he will rescue us from your hand. Now, after we've watched this little drama, which Megan and Marcus did so well with, then these words seem to be easy words to speak for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. But we know how that scene is going to end, don't we? We know that. Even as we read the story, it's like, oh, I love this story because I know what's going to happen. We know that God does rescue these faithful men from the sting of the fire. But we have to remember, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego did not know what was going to happen that day.
Yeah, that's right.
They did not know what was going to happen. As I've studied and thought about these words in verse 17, I really don't believe these words were spoken like a prophecy. I don't think they were prophesying when they said these things. I don't think that these three men were saying that God would rescue them. I think they were pronouncing a profession of faith that God could rescue them. They understood that God is sovereign. They understood that God controls all of creation, which he himself had made. They understood that God is the rescuer of both this life and the life to come. In faith, they pronounced the conviction that God would save them. One way or another, out of death or through death, God would rescue them. But the most decisive words, I think, in these verses, I think, are found in verse 18. In verse 17, as we just saw, these three young men proclaim, if we are thrown into the fiery furnace, God is able to save, he's able to rescue us. But then we read in verse 18, but even if he does not, we want you to know, O King, that we will not serve your gods. The faith of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego was a faith that said, even if we lose everything, even if we are hurt, even if we are alone, even if we feel abandoned, even if we cannot see the immediate evidence of God's presence right now in our lives, even if everything goes wrong and we are threatened with losing everything, we will not give up. We will not let go of our faith. We will remain faithful to the God who called us, and we will not serve your gods. God grant us the integrity and the faith of a Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. You know, we are not called to an easy faith. So many want to trust God and obey God only when the way is easy, only when everyone else is clamoring to do the same thing. Many want to serve God only while they can save face, because sometimes we can do that, only while they can maintain their status and their convenience. But God calls us to complete obedience. He calls us to complete obedience. And so we need to ask ourselves, are we living our lives as Christians with integrity? God never promised us, Christ never promised us, that we would have things easy. As a matter of fact, Christ tells us the way of faith will be filled with difficulties. I mean, he talks about carrying a cross. Now, we can romanticize the idea of a cross pretty easily sometimes, 2,000 years later, but there's nothing romantic about a cross. He speaks of opposition from the world. Jesus mentions opposition. Sometimes it'll even come within our own families. Too many of us want to follow God only while the way is easy, only while the way is smooth, only while the way is downhill. But what if there's fire? What if there's fire? How will you live your life if there's fire? You see, some people choose to run from the fire. They hide, they duck, they'll even disappear completely while the fire is present. But the result of that is that their lives end up being empty and virtually meaningless. I'm reminded of the story I once heard about King George of England. When the late King George was visiting a pottery plant some years ago, then two special vases were shown to him. Both were made of the same material and both had been painted in the same manner and style. But one was a beautiful ornament, and the other was blurred and unsightly. The king looked at the two vases and said, "Well, you can sure tell the difference between the quality of the materials, can't you?" And the manager of the place came and said, "Your Majesty, what you see is not the difference in quality. In fact, the quality of both vases is exactly the same. They are both formed from the same clay. The same paints were applied to both vessels, and the same skillful artist actually did the painting." "Well, why are they so different then?" the king asked. "Why is one of them ugly and useless, and the other is a priceless treasure?" The manager of the pottery plant answered, "It's really quite simple, Your Majesty. The vase that is now priceless went through the fire. The other one did not." So there's a question that confronts us this day. Are we willing to take the fire? Are we willing to take the stand of fire? God is certainly able to save us from it. God has the power to save us from it. God can rescue us from all of our troubles. God has the power to change the circumstances. He can erase the problem. He has the power and ability to deliver you a new job. He can eliminate the colleague who's harassing you, hopefully not in an ultimate way, but get rid of him, fire him. He can heal your sickness. He can take away your financial woes. He can reconcile your family. He can even fix your car. God has the power to save you from every problem, even from the hint of trouble. God has the power to do that. But what if he doesn't? That's the real question. What if he doesn't? What if there's fire? You know, I'm convinced that the integrity of our Christian life is not proven while the way is easy. It is proven when we face fire. The effectiveness of our witness is not convincing when everything is going our way. It's convincing when there's fire in our life. The reality and blessing of God's call in our lives to be ministers and leaders and those who reach out to the people around us is not proven when life is easy and the sailing is smooth and everything's going our way. It's proven by how we react and stick it out when there's fire, when things are not going the way we want them to go, the way that no one wants them to go. That's when the proving takes place. Today we live in a world of fire. We live in a world of fire. Our culture challenges today more than any other day in America to step into the fire. It challenges us. It laughs at us. It ridicules us. It says that the Christian life is just not worth it. And the question is, what are we going to do? How are we going to respond? There's really no avoiding it. Not anymore. There may have been a year, a time in the United States you could avoid it. You can't avoid this anymore. We must either save faith and step into the fire, or we must back down, save face, and bow to the statues of money, or popularity, or position, or comfort, or public opinion. I'm here this morning to tell you one thing. Step into the fire.
Amen.
It's not a popular decision. It's not easy. In fact, it'll probably even hurt. But there's a marvelous truth that we learn from the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. The truth that we learn is that the only path to true spiritual victory runs directly through the fire. It runs directly through the fire. There's no other way. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego chose to take the fire. There's a very fascinating element to this story that we need to approach carefully in terms of our interpretation. I think that it provides with a significant truth about the journey of faith. In the skit that we watched, we heard the words that the king says in verse 25. The Bible says in verse 25 that King Nebuchadnezzar uttered when he looked in on the three young men who were in that fiery furnace. I'm sure you didn't miss that part. They did a great job of showing that. When King Nebuchadnezzar looked in at the three young men in the fiery furnace, he called out in amazement these words we see in verse 25. He said, "Look, I see four men in the fire, walking around unbound and unharmed, and the fourth looks like a son of the gods." Literally, the text says, "a son of the gods." I know that we need to be careful how we jump to any major conclusions about the true identity of this son of the gods that this pagan king recognized in the fire. Most commentators believe this is probably a reference to an angel or some other kind of celestial being. But what do you think? Could this son of the gods actually have been the son of God? I don't know. I think it's possible that Jesus himself was perhaps in that furnace. But here's what I do know. These three young men did not encounter this son of the gods until they actually stepped into that fire. And the fact is, Christ himself also went through the fire. When Christ left his glory behind in heaven to take upon himself the flesh and form of humanity, believe me, he stepped into the fire. When he confronted the wrong priorities and self-righteousness of the Pharisees, he stepped into that fire. When he struggled and prayed and sweat drops that looked like blood fell from his face in the Garden of Gethsemane, he stepped into that fire. When he surrendered himself to the abusive and cruel hands of the Roman captors, he didn't run away from the fire, he stepped right in the middle of it. When he silently absorbed the abuse and ridicule of the Jewish religious leaders as they mockingly challenged him to come down from the cross and save himself, he endured the flames of the fire. When Christ struggled for his last strangled breath on the cross, when he finally died on behalf of the sins of you and me, he went through the fire.
Amen.
But you know what? I'm convinced that if we want to live Christ-like lives, we must go through the same kind of fire. As a matter of fact, I think that Christ lives in the middle of the fire. If you want to meet Christ, if you want to have true spiritual victory in your life, I don't think there's any other way. You need to step into that fire. I'm afraid that too many people spend their entire lives hiding from the fire. And the truly ironic, tragically ironic things is a lot of these people spend their lives hiding from the fire in the church of all places. They're hiding from the fire in the church. And then they simply cannot understand why they can't seem to gain spiritual victory. They can't understand why they can't seem to find the power of the Savior. They wonder why they can't find the joy of Christ. Do you want to find the Son of God? Do you want to meet the Savior? Step into the fire. This is where Jesus lived his own life, in the midst of the fire. And this is where he calls us to live as well, as his followers. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they stepped into the fire, and they met the Son of God. They met the Savior. They met the one who gives true spiritual victory. And so we need to ask ourselves that question again today. What about us? Are we running and hiding from the fire? Have things gotten too hot for us here in Colorado Springs? Does the way seem to be too difficult? Are the lessons that we are learning just too demanding? Do the sacrifices seem to be too great? Stop hiding from the fire. Stop hiding from the fire. Step into it. Take the challenge. Remain faithful to the call that God has given you, whatever that call is. The fact of the matter is, I don't know exactly what your fire is. Your fire could be a difficult job you're working. Your fire could be the doubt that God loves you, or the doubt that God has called you, or the doubt that God could even use someone who has the past that you have experienced. I don't know what your fire is. I know if God's challenging you to tithe. I know if he's challenging you to witness to your neighbors, and you just are afraid to do that. Or maybe there's some bad attitudes that continue just fight against you, and you're just afraid to confront them. You're so used to having those things come out, we just don't even want to fight against it. Or a negative spirit about everything that goes on around us is negative. I don't know what your fire is, but you know. And God knows. And he wants you to step into that fire. We don't win the victory by running away from the fire. We win the victory by obediently and faithfully stepping into it. By trusting God, praying for his strength, stepping into the fire. And in the midst of that fire, Christ is waiting for us.
Amen.
He's waiting for us.
Amen.
Do you want to meet him? Step into his fire. Let's pray, shall we? Heavenly Father, I'm not exactly sure which parts of our lives we need to surrender to you this morning. Because so many times there are situations in our life that we're just kind of holding on to ourselves because we're afraid of what it might mean to give that up, or we're afraid of what someone might think if we were to go a different direction, or if we would display a different attitude, or if we would truly trust you fully. But Father, this morning, as your Holy Spirit is speaking to us, I pray that you would help us to let go and to step in that fire. Because you go with us and you strengthen us. And so many times during the struggles and the difficulties and the fires that we can run into in life, it's precisely during these times when you, Father, purify our faith and strengthen our faith. Just as a fire purifies gold, so you also allow these types of fires. I don't think you cause these fires, but you use these fires to purify our lives as we surrender everything to you. And in doing so, we gain a Savior. We gain someone who sanctifies us. Someone who purifies us. Someone who fills us completely with his presence. Father, we give you thanks for Jesus Christ. And so, Father, in this day, whatever those struggles are that we seem to keep bumping up against, and just afraid to take that step of fully giving them to you, I'd ask you to do that right now. In the stillness of our heart, there doesn't need to be some type of fanfare in which we do that. But this is just between us and you, God. We give that to you. And we surrender that to you. And we dedicate that completely to you. And we step into the fire to allow you to cleanse us and to purify us through faith and trust in you. Father, I thank you for the great example of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These three young men who lived lives of integrity, where they held on to their faith regardless of what anyone said. I ask that you give us that same boldness, that same strength. Indeed, your Holy Spirit who lives within us gives us that strength if we will trust you and step out in faith with you into that fire. And so, Lord, this week, I'm not sure what's going to come into our lives. I'm not sure if we're going to go through one of these weeks where they just is free sailing downhill, wind at our back, or if it's going to be a week of fire. But I thank you, Lord, that you are more powerful than any fire. You're able to rescue us from those situations. But even if not, Father, we acknowledge our dependence upon you. We acknowledge our trust in you. We acknowledge our faith in you, that we will stand firm and strong with you beside us, and we'll give you thanks and praise. And so as we go from this place, Father, we thank you for the strength you give to us. I thank you for your ongoing presence in our life, your Holy Spirit. I thank you for Jesus Christ's love, who buoys us up and encourages us and strengthens us in every way. And it's in the power of your presence, Father, that we give ourselves to you and we go into this week to your glory and for your honor. These things we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. The Lord bless you. Step in the fire. Amen.